Felicitous greetings, fellow fanatics.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Adam the Fanatic, and today I'm taking a look at Aegis, Combining Robot Strategy Game. A strategy game about combining robots by Zephyr Workshop. You may recall that late last year I did my first interview with Breeze Grigas, the lead designer of Aegis, and I also showcased the game's tabletop simulator mod back when my channel was first starting out. Today, it's time I finally take a look at this game where you must fight and unite. In Aegis, 2 to 4 players will battle it out for supremacy with 5 robots. And for those who want even bigger battles, there's also a 6-player mat available. Players will take turns advancing their robots, positioning them, and trading shots with one another. They'll also have the option to combine 2 robots together to form larger, more powerful robots. Players have to be wary though. The robots are not only their combatants, but also their logistics. If ever their total energy production drops below 5, that player is out of the game. To set up, each player will bring a team of 7 level 1 robots. We'll get more into team building later, but right out of the box, you'll have 8 pre-constructed teams to get you used to the game. For this review, we'll be looking at a standard 1v1 match between the poster boys. Einar brings his Arc 150 to the fray and likes to get up close and personal with his foes, while Etwall's Excel 100 grows stronger as commander each time another robot falls. For a single game, you'll only use 5 robots, and a reference card shows the recommended team you bring for a single game. For tournament play, you'll play best 2 out of 3, and can switch out robots from your sideboard between games. You'll also need an energy tracker, each commander has their own, and the matching standee for each of the robots you're fielding. The board is double-sided, with one side for 4 players and the other side for 2. Each of them has a recommended preset pattern for obstacles, though you can set them up however you and your opponent like for free play. On your turn, you'll start by refilling your energy to its current maximum. In the case of Einar, we can see that his team produces a total of 19 energy, represented by the green cubes in the top right corner of the robot cards. Keep in mind that you do not carry over excess energy left over from your last turn. You'll then be able to activate each of your robots one at a time, first opting to move that robot, then being able to take an action with them. You may opt out of movement or taking an action for a robot, but unless stated otherwise, you may only move before taking an action, not after. Each space of movement costs 1 energy, though no matter how much energy a team has, an individual robot cannot spend more energy on movement than what's listed on the top center of their card. Most robots have to move around obstacles and other robots, but if a robot has flying, it can move over walls and robots, but may still only stop on an empty space. Einar's team has some pretty speedy bots, especially his Arc 150, which can move up to 7 spaces in 1 turn, making it quite the trailblazer. But if you spend all that energy there, that's less you have to attack or pour into the rest of your robots. Generally, the first 2 or 3 rounds will just be getting into position. They go by pretty quickly, but let's fast forward to a point where we can take a look at combat. Here, Einar has just finished up his 2nd turn, lining up his robots to strike in the 3rd round. It's now Etwall's turn. His Excel 100 has the Magnificence ability, which gives it 1 additional energy, movement, and integrity, that's the robot's hit points, for each robot he's lost. So he decides he's going to push forward with his L100 and E-Jet 100, neither of which is used in his combined robots. Etwall will try and use them to hit the enemy a few times and distract them as they're taken out, empowering his commander in the process. The E-Jet is going to be the first wave of attack, but before that, he wants to have the Arlie 100 use its overclock signal bursting. To do this, Etwall spends 5 energy and rolls an equal amount of dice. This ability has an accuracy of 1 and a blue circle around it. This means that all dice rolled must be equal to or higher than 1 to succeed, which is impossible to fail under normal circumstances. After that, we see the attack's effect. It gives a damage buff to all robots in range 3 around itself. This means that those robots will deal 1 extra damage on all attacks until the start of Etwall's next turn. Keep in mind that if there were any enemies nearby, they would benefit from this too. With this in mind, the E-Jet zooms forward at full speed. It has the Jet 2 ability, so it flies and only uses 1 energy to move 2 spaces. It's going to spend its maximum of 3 energy on movement to get right into the thick of the enemy forces and unleash its aerial bullet spray, targeting the Ender 100. As before, the first thing we do is check for the energy costs, this time 4, and roll the same number of dice. However, this time, there's a green circle. This means we check each die individually as a success or failure. In this case, we have 3 successes, and we can see that each success does 1 damage. We add the 1 from the buff earlier, and that's a total of 4 damage. Here we can see that this attack can target a robot within 4 spaces, but it also has a spread of 1, meaning all robots adjacent to the target will also take the hit. This is enough to instantly shoot down the Ender 100, which we see has 4 integrity, and severely damage the Go 400, which barely survives with 5. The good news for Einar is that Etwall doesn't have enough energy to move another robot into range and attack with it this turn, so he'll spend his last 3 energy to begin moving the sacrificial L100 into position. Now it's Einar's turn. They want to take out the E-Jet, but they have to go about it carefully. Firstly, they produce 3 less energy with the Ender gone. And to make matters even worse, the E-Jet has Parting Shot 4, allowing it to deal 1 damage to any robot within 4 hexes when it's destroyed. That would finish off the go. They begin by spending 2 energy to move the Ark into position, firing its custom arm Vulcans for an additional 2 energy. He rolls his dice and has 1 success, but 1 just isn't good enough for his plans. Einar's commander ability is First Pilot. This means that the first robot he takes an action with each round can spend 1 energy to reroll a single die, which he does to reroll that failure and turn it into another success for 2 damage. With the go, he wants to combine. Combining is an action, so the robot initiating it can move first, but cannot make an attack on the same turn it combines, as that would be using up its action for the turn. In this case, he wants to form the Ark 2500. In order to combine, the 2 robots must be adjacent. The Ark 2500 has Ark in its name, so one of the combining robots must be of the Ark series as well. On top of that, it's a commander robot, which can only be formed by the matching commander. In this case, Einar with the Ark 150 meets both those requirements. The Ark 2500 is an AG type, which means it must be made by level 1 robots with the same types. Since the Ark 150 is an A type, it needs a G type. In this case, the Go 400 is acceptable material. To combine, Einar pays an energy cost equal to the energy production of the new robot, in this case, 6, and removes the robots that form it from the game. The new robot starts on either of the 2 spaces occupied by the robots that combine to form it. When a robot is formed by combining, it comes in with full integrity and energy production, and does not carry over any buffs or debuffs that its material robots may have had. Most combined robots cannot activate on the same turn that they're formed, but instead will have green abilities or attacks that occur for free when they form. In the case of the Ark 2500, its ability is Ignition, which allows it to circumvent the normal rules and activate as soon as it's combined. Einar will spend 2 more energy to activate its Twin Buster shot. It only gets 1 success. It can't reroll this time, but that's all it needs, taking down the E-Jet. He'll still take 1 damage for the parting shot, but with the Ark 2500's sturdy 7 integrity, it's not in any immediate danger. Einar has 3 energy left to maneuver his remaining robots, then it'll be Etwall's turn once again. Turns will go back and forth like this until one player produces less than 5 energy each turn, or has no way of dealing damage or pushing robots off the edge of the map. In either case, that player will lose, and the opposing player will win the game. In addition to the standard 1v1 game just described, the rules also include instructions on how to play free-for-all and team games with more players, as well as having rules for a number of alternate modes, including gridless, draft, and point play. For those who want even more options, there's also a scenario book available, which has a number of pre-crafted games that go through the lore of the world of Zagaia, often with their own unique rule sets. Like many games, the true complexities and depths of Aegis come not from learning the rules themselves, but from the many different ways that the individual robots interact with one another. Although I've named a few of the special abilities and effects robots are capable of in the game, I've scarcely scratched the surface. Level 1 robots are divided into 5 different classes, each of which represent a different letter in the Aegis acrostic. Assault types are typically offensive, favor short to medium range attacks, and produce a lot of energy. They also have a number of offensive buffs they can give to their allies. Evade class robots are typically swift, often have fly, and are the only robots that have jet. And as their name suggests, they many times have ways to make it harder to hit them. Guard types usually have low energy production, but high integrity values, and also often have attacks that push or pull instead of dealing direct damage. You can still damage robots by slamming them into walls or each other, or even eliminate them instantly by knocking them off the map. Intel type robots favor trickery over direct damage, and are capable of draining enemies' energy reserves and inflicting lots of annoying debuffs. And finally, support types are often capable of repairing allies, while the more offensive S-class robots tend to have very long range. They also have the highest average energy production of the 5 classes. Level 2 and higher robots are always made up of different classes. So for example, you'll never see an AA class robot, but you'll see things like an AS or a GI. Higher level robots are more difficult to bring to the field, but each brings their own unique strategies with them. While you may not see Aegis class robots very often, they're quite imposing when they do hit the board. Then we come to team building. When building a team, you select 7 level 1 robots with only 3 real restrictions. Firstly, no robot may be repeated within your team. You may have robots from the same series, so for example, the Get 100 and Get 400 could both be on the same team if you wish, but you wouldn't be allowed to have 2 Get 100s. Secondly, you may only have 1 commander. Most commanders are tied to a specific robot, but there's also a number of machineless commanders, each of which specifies how they can be used. Thirdly, some robots will have one of the 5 faction symbols under their class type. You don't necessarily need a faction, but if you pick any robot or commander from one faction, that locks you out of the other 4. The most recent tournament also had a limit of 10 combined robots per player. Well, this has varied from tournament to tournament, and there is no limit for casual play. Component-wise, the game is quite solid. The cards are a fair bit larger than standard poker size and of decent thickness. Of course, you're not going to be doing much shuffling unless you're especially fond of the draft variant. The game also comes with 10 custom dice. They're not engraved, but they're easily readable with their thematic pips. The game comes with enough tokens to keep track of all the special effects you may need to, as well as an insert to keep everything organized between games. As far as default organizers goes, this is one of the better ones that I've seen included with the game. If I do have one complaint about the components, it has to be the energy trackers. While they're functional, they're also made of the same material and are the same thickness as the cards themselves. For something this large, I kinda wish they were made out of cardboard, though naturally that would have upped the cost since there are a dozen of them included in the game. All in all, Aegis is an impressive title. Although the dice chucking will definitely turn some away, it's a great game for both casual fans and strategy enthusiasts alike. New players will be able to jump in and enjoy it right away with the pre-built teams. But with 100 robots included in the box, there's plenty in there for all those who want to study the ins and outs of the finer details. I describe myself as a casual mech anime fan, and I'm certainly more than a casual board game fan. If you just want the feeling of mechs slugging it out with one another, there are plenty of options for that. But Aegis is the only game I'm aware of that allows you to combine robots in a satisfying manner. In conclusion, I find Aegis Combining Robot Strategy Game to be worthy of an astounding 9.7 out of 10. While I've mentioned the Aegis Tabletop Simulator mod before, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring attention to it once again. If you're interested in trying the full game for free before seeking to buy, this is one of the most robust mods out there, officially supported by the game's creators. You can build your own team or use any of the pre-builts with a push of a button. It even includes 5 additional pre-built teams for the commander robots that don't have them in the physical version. It includes all the promos for you to play around with, and it's consistently updated. And finally, on the subject of promos, I feel I need to briefly praise the dev philosophy that no gameplay-related component should ever be impossible for new players to find. So long as Aegis is reprinted, so too will any card that adds value to gameplay, though perhaps with an aesthetic difference so the original remains a collector's item, without locking new players out of gameplay content. If you're interested in purchasing Aegis, trying it out on Tabletop Simulator, or learning more, links are included in the description. But what about you? What do you think of Aegis? Are you looking forward to the second wave of content hitting Kickstarter? If you have any questions, remarks, or opposing points of view, leave them in the comments down below. And please remember to like, share, subscribe, and ring that bell. Until next time, farewell, fellow fanatics. Thank you again for watching. I have plenty more to share with you if you're interested. You can click up here above my head to subscribe to my channel. You can click over here on my monitor to see the most recent video that I've worked on. Or if you prefer, you can click up here to open this mysterious vault and see what video that the YouTube algorithm has picked just for you.